Well, you can start now.
Hello. Hi, everyone.
Hi, Daphne, you well?
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, Eva.
Okay, so just now you couldn't hear me, is it?
Right, because you are muted.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry about that. Okay, so shall we start now?
Sure.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our 2020 Region 10 SYWL Virtual Congress Student Activities Track. My name is Ewell. I'm a staff of IEEE supporting our respectable volunteers in IEEE, especially in Region 10. Today, I'm very honored to be the moderator for these sessions. The topic for this session today is IEEE Xplore, New Services and Platform. I am pretty sure that you will find these sessions very informative and rewarding, as today we have a very knowledgeable speaker. Before I begin the session, I would like to share with you some ground rules and protocol. To prevent the background noises and encore, all the attendees are muted on entry. You are not able to unmute yourself. You are welcome to introduce yourself in the chat box. Make sure that you send a message to all participants. Please use the chat feature to share your comments, questions throughout the presentation, and we will do our best to address all the questions that you have. Please take note that this session is being recorded. Now, I would like to give a warm welcome to our Region 10 student representative, Ms. Savita, to give us a welcoming remark. Savita, please.
Thank you so much, Ivel. Hello, everyone. A very good morning to you all. This is Savita Sivakumar. I'm the Region 10 student representative, and I'm so glad to welcome Alex as our guest speaker today for the talk titled on IEEE Xplore, New Services and Platforms and More. This will be our session 5 under the student track of SYWLC 2020. As you all know, IEEE Xplore is one of the most important tools of IEEE, which not only being utilized by IEEE members, but also other researchers and students. It has a wide range of IEEE papers, resources, items, more than 5 million, and one of the top cited journals as well. So it is very important for researchers to be updated with their new tools and resources associated with IEEE Xplore. As such, I believe that this session is going to be something very interesting and useful for all of you and me as well. So I'm looking forward to learn a lot new things from Alex today. One more time, Alex, welcome, and looking forward. Over to you, Eva.
Thank you so much, Savita, for a wonderful opening remark. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce you our speaker today, Mr. Alex Liu. So let me briefly introduce Alex. Alex is currently the Manager Client Services Asia in IEEE. He is supporting our customer researchers in Southeast Asia, Japan, Korea, Australia, and New Zealand. He is responsible to provide training and technical support to the librarians, researchers, students, and R&D engineers to utilize the IEEE Xplore platform for research and to share the publication process with IEEE publications, especially for the journals and conferences. Alex has been working at National University of Singapore prior to that, and also the Singapore government. So now, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, let us give a warm welcome to our speaker today, Alex Liu, to give you a presentation on IEEE Xplore. Alex, the time is yours.
Thank you, Yuel. Thanks, everyone, for joining for today's sharing. Allow me to start the sharing of my PowerPoint slides first. Just give me 1 minute. Once again, thanks to our panelists as well as our participants for joining for today. I notice we do have quite a number of participants today. And for our participants, I will highly recommend to join the discussions. I'm taking a screenshot of what you are seeing from your end, hopefully. As you can see from the bottom right corner, sometimes it's on top of your screen. Actually on top of your screen, you'll see a row of icons. If you move your cursor to the top of the screen, it will say pause, share, start reading, participants. One of them is chat, and the last one is a three dot. If you click on it, there's a Q&A as well. You can use the chat box to start keying your questions or the things that you are interested in. And I will try to answer your questions along the way. And this is the official title of my sharing today. And I notice on the line we have a small group of participants. Again, I would like to make the session to be interactive. If you have any questions, anything you'd like to share, you'd like to chat, please use the chat box to chat. All right, try not to use your microphone because more than one person speaking at the same time, there might be a lot of background noise. So use the chat box to ask your questions. I do have a quick agenda for today. I will be starting with a very quick introduction to IEEE, and I believe this part for our student members, you are very familiar. I will just highlight a few things that you may not be taking much attention to, but it's important, especially if you want to become a researcher or if you want to continue your studies in engineering. Most of my time will be spent on the last three points, which I will guide you through some PowerPoint sharing as well as a live demonstration to highlight the latest development of IEEE Xplore platform, as well as some new features, new topics, new functionalities, which you can use to help your research and studies. Let's start with something that you already know, which is, what is IEEE? All right, I'm not going to give you an answer. If you have an answer, use the chat box to give me your answer. What does IEEE stand for? Next, what we have is obviously the background. We are a membership association. The whole idea of this organization is for advancing technical innovation and excellence for the benefits of humanities. And the next one, you want to let me know, how many of these four, what we call the core activities or the core pillars of IEEE that you have been part of? I'm sure everyone here is part of the first one, which is members and technical societies. You are a student member, you join your different, your local sections or chapters, you join your student branches, you are part of the core activities of what IEEE does. And that's our foundation of everything that is possible. What do I mean by that? If you look at the next four core activities, standards association, the journals, the conferences, as well as the educational activities, those four activities are not possible without the support of our members and our technical societies. That includes our student members as well. For example, some of you might have published or attended some of the conferences. Some of you, especially if you have been a senior member, if you have been a postgraduate student, you might have published in one of the journals. So that's what IEEE does, the five core activities. And why am I highlighting this for you, which is something you already know? Because as a student, as of now, yes, you are doing your studies, but think about the future. Now you might be doing your undergraduate studies. After that is postgraduate. Some of us might straight away go and join the workforce, become an engineer. And when you become an engineer, most likely, especially for those who are dealing with still doing engineering jobs, most likely somehow sooner or later, you will be dealing with some of the standards. I'm talking about standards, IEEE standards. I'm sure nowadays everyone has a mobile phone. The fact that you have a mobile phone, the mobile phone itself complies at least with three or more IEEE standards. That's how widely IEEE standards are being used. And as a graduate student, you have to read journals and hopefully publish in journals as well as conferences. And as an engineer working in the industry or professional researcher working in the universities, most likely you have to join conferences, participate in conferences. And in the later part of your career, you might be the one organizing the conferences. And with that, you'll be part of the frontier of the research. Educational activities is something new. What this unit does is, in the past few years, it has been generating a number of e-learning courses, online courses which you can watch on your computers at your own pace. You can repeatedly watch them, the accompanying notes and materials which you can learn from them. And this year, the year of 2020, the crazy year of COVID-19, forced everyone to adopt this new way of learning, just like what we are doing now. We are hosting an online seminar. So educational courses provide some online courses, online modules which you can learn about the new technologies, for example 5G, blockchain, smart sensors, smart cities, Internet of Things, cybersecurity, all those are covered in these educational activities. And for those who are familiar with IEEE Xplore, IEEE Xplore actually has the standards, IEEE standards. It also has the journals, it has the conferences, it also has the online courses. Again, the four activities at the bottom are not possible without our members, without our technical societies, without our student members. So you are actually part of these activities as well. IEEE has been growing tremendously. I'm sure as a member, we all know now we have almost 420,000 members. And in terms of IEEE Xplore, it has over 5 million documents. And in fact, this number is not even up to date. If you go to IEEE Xplore now, the actual number is more than 5.2 million documents. That's a even larger number. And every year we have a lot of new content being added. I'm sure we have students who are studying in universities, right? I hope so. And if you are a researcher or student who are currently from the universities, you will want to let me know using your chat box that your school has IEEE Xplore. Do you know whether your school has IEEE Xplore? And if they do, you want to tell me your school name, which school you're from, your school has it, my school doesn't have it, just let me know. And it covers all the subjects, not only electrical and electronics. It also covers computer science and among others. And we have over 5.2 million documents, a lot of ebooks, a lot of standards, a lot of journals, a lot of conference titles. And you notice the last one I'm showing, we have more than 1.7 million contributing authors, which means there are at least 1.7 million researchers who have submitted a research paper to IEEE. And I'm sure in the future, some of us will also be publishing with some of the IEEE journals and conferences. And with that, you will be joining these 1.7 million authors, being part of the frontier, the leaders in terms of engineering research. In terms of the categories of content that is included in IEEE Xplore, I'm highlighting the five core content which you can find in IEEE Xplore. And you notice I even highlighted the first three. Let me go through all the five of them and I'll explain to you why I'm highlighting the first three. We have journals, transactions, and magazines. These are the publications that cover the research papers, the full-length research paper, from the research topics to the results. Conference proceedings, conference papers cover the latest research topics, the latest research methodologies in terms of research, and IEEE standards, they are actually the guidelines used not only by engineers, but also by industries and companies to make, to design, to produce, to manufacture, and to provide service for the people. And if you can recall what I have told you about 3 minutes earlier, if you ever going to become an engineer working in the industry, sooner or later you will be dealing with IEEE standards. For example, if you are going to work for a world-leading telecommunication or computer company, manufacturing for sensors, for motherboard, for antenna, for mobile phones, then definitely during your work you have to refer to some of the IEEE standards because they are heavily used in engineering, especially electrical, electronic, computer science. Educational courses, this refers to the educational activities, educational unit. They produce a lot of online learning courses. And we also have a lot of ebook collections. I need to give you some hint here. There will be a quiz after today's sharing, and what I'm going to show you, or what I have shown you, will be tested in the quiz. And one of the quiz questions is about this slide. So remember, there are at least five major categories of content. They are journals, conferences, standards, e-learning courses, ebooks. And why am I highlighting the first three? Because as an author in the future, especially if you are ever going to become a graduate student, you need to publish. Where do you publish? You publish in journals and conferences, right? That's why I'm highlighting the first two. Why am I highlighting the standards? If you're ever going to become an engineer working in the industries, you will be using standards sooner or later. The qualities of the journals are very good. This is like a ranking, you know, when you take your exam, like how did I perform? Am I in the top 5%, the top 10% of my class, or am I at the bottom? So this is actually a ranking, not comparing to ourselves. We are comparing to all the journals across the board. The rankings in terms of subjects, they are very, very good. In terms of leading subjects, and I'm sure we have some students working on emerging technologies such as medical informatics, bioinformatics, remote sensing, robotics. These are hot topics. As you can see, IEEE publications, the ranks are very good. And even in traditional domains, electrical, electronic, and telecommunications, 9 of the top 10 are actually from us. And all the top 10 journals on telecommunications are from us. If you want to read, read the best. If you want to publish, aim to publish at the best. This is another one highlighting the performance last year. We have new journals, artificial intelligence, information theory, industrial electronics, information theory, technology, and society. And why I'm not showing this, the topics that IEEE covers varies a lot from both theoretical research to industrial applications. So as a researcher, as an engineer, it's very good for you to read those publications. We have a lot of conferences as well. We have a lot of e-books. Those e-books will help you to have a quick understanding of the latest research topics. We have online libraries, which you can watch the videos online, but then of course, whether the online library is available really depends on your school's subscription. If they have it, then you can watch them. All right, that's a very quick illustration or explanation of the platform. Allow me to pause here, and I'll be open for questions. Feel free to ask your questions. In the meanwhile, let me switch to my browser. What I will do is, I will be showing you how IEEE Xplore works. I'm showing my browser right now, so if you have any questions, feel free to use the chat or Q&A to ask. Look at this number, 5.2 million documents, right? More than 5.2, actually more than almost 5.3. All right, the first thing first is, you have to make sure you will be able to see this line. Access provided by your school name. Only if you see your school name, then you can read the full text PDF document. Otherwise, you can't read the full text. Some of you might be asking, how do I make sure that I can get to see my university name or organization name? Who should I ask for help? If you ever have that problem, please ask your librarians from your libraries. Like, they will be the one that knows how to set this up. So that's for this. Next, I will quickly guide you through the front page, and I will show you how the search works. So in here, you have the featured authors, some of the top ranking authors, like from India, Canada, the Netherlands, some featured articles. I will highly recommend you to read those featured articles, because if you look at the topics, it's very interesting, from artificial intelligence, and this is variable monitoring. If you don't know what it is, it's actually Apple Watch. Something similar to that, right? Something you can wear it with you, and yet it monitors your health status. And this one is on robotics. It's all on the world leading research. These are some new updates for the platform or features. We have some upcoming conferences. And let me show you how to quickly do a search. Of course, everybody does search. Everybody use Google every day. Why do I need to know that? But do you ever do a search like this? Do we do search like this? And what am I doing here? I'm constructing a more comprehensive or more complicated searching. For example, I use an asterisk to represent a truncation. I use the word AND to connect the two concepts. One is sense or sensing, another one is this concept. And why do I use asterisk? Asterisk represents a few letters. For example, from sense to sensing to sensor. So it's all represented by using the same concept here. And I'm using the letter AND, which is to combine the two concepts. And why am I using brackets? Is to make sure that they will perform this operation first, which has something to do with all. All means either one, right? And I'm using the quotation to make sure I'm searching exactly the same Internet of Things. Some of you might be asking, hey Alex, you're too fast. What are all these details? How can I get more information? Not to worry, if you'd like to know more, all you have to do is click on a one search. It will explain to you how all this works. Look at the right-hand side, learn more. We have data fields, search examples, search operator, search tips. All is explained here. Not only that, with a one search, you can even search within the defined domain. Like, I'm only searching for certain authors. Like, I know my supervisor's name. I can search by his name, search in authors. Or I want to find out all the publications from a particular school. Say I'm going to study in Harvard. I will try to find out all the publications that are published by Harvard University. Search for all citations. And as you can see, and or not, they are all built up for you. For today, due to time constraint, I can't share with you everything here, but please spend some time on the one search. So I'm only giving you a quick example of this. For example, I can change this one to, let's say, all. Right? Then I do a search. In the search result page, there are a lot of functionalities. For example, what we have is it will tell you what kind of content are available. Conferences, journals, magazines, or e-learning courses. On the left-hand side, you can refine by year. I'm looking for the latest publications in the past 11 years. And I can also look at who are the top authors. This particular person has published 1,000 articles. That's like crazy. This person has published 600 articles. Or if you want to know which school has been publishing a lot, like this one from US, GPL, NTU from Singapore, US, seems like US is very strong on this. This will help you if you want to know which school you want to go for your postgraduate studies or your postdoc research, right? I'm going to aim for GPL because they work for NASA, all right? So that's for all certifications. And furthermore, you can use these publication topics to refine further. For example, I'm only interested in wireless sensor networks. Then I will just select this wireless sensor networks, click apply. It allows me to further zoom in to less results. Right? This is less result. Of course, you can add in another keyword, say cars or automobiles. Click on the search again. You're adding an additional keywords to perform the search. So from 60,000 to 300, this is much easier to manage. And with this limited number of results, then you can sort by relevance or the newest if you want to look for the latest publications, or you can sort by most cited by, say, by papers. What paper, what research has been cited a lot? And we realize some of the research papers, like this one, is published 7 years ago. But in the past 7 years, it has gotten 200 public citations. This is a crazy number. If I am this particular person, I'm this researcher, I will be very proud. And furthermore, you notice this is a single author paper. It's published in one of the IEEE journals. And this is very good research. If you are working on this particular area or domain, you may want to read this particular paper. So that's for this. If you want to remove the keywords, say I realize 300 is too small, I want to get more, all I have to do is just click on the cross, just click on it. It goes back to the 60,000 results. Then you can add another keyword, say buildings. Then you can search again. This is how you move forward and backward. There's another thing I would like to highlight to you, which is, my apologies, because I didn't use it for a while. So as you can see now, I can't see my institutional name. I can't see my account name. That's why you see all those, it's red color, it's all locked because it's not in the subscription. I'm not accessing from my school. So allow me to just give you 1 minute. I will log in again. Then you will be able to see the lock will be opened with the account. Again, if you don't know how this works, or if you do not know how to access it from your particular school, please check with your librarian. Go to your library, ask them, or send them an email, ask them for help. How can I access this? Give me 1 minute, I'll log in, and I will bring up the browser again, and you will be able to see the school name. Access provided by IEL demo user. All right, so now as you can see, these locks are open, which means the door is open. I can read it. So for example, I'm going to read this PDF. I'll open in another browser. I'm sure everyone is familiar with reading PDF, right? We have been dealing with PDF all the time. So once the PDF is open, you can start reading like an article. It's usually in two columns. Sometimes you have figures and diagrams. Sometimes you may have some mathematical equations. But the problem for PDF is you can't save the figure. How do I save this image? I right click, save as, but you realize you are saving it as a PDF. You see, it's a PDF. You're not saving it as a document, as an image, as a picture, right? You're not saving it as a picture. So how do I save it as a picture? How do I save these math equations? What I recommend you to do is read the HTML. HTML is pretty much like a web page. And with a web page, I'm sure some of us, we might have saved pictures from the internet, right? You find this picture of a sky, it's very nice. A picture of this lake is very beautiful. You save that picture. Or how do you save it? Right click, save as. Image, JPEG, GIF, PNG file, like this. Very simple. Save image as. Now, as you can see, you are saving it as a GIF file. This is an image, right? You can right click and save. The same goes for this figure as well. Save image as a GIF file. So that's how simple it is. HTML has these flexibilities. The next thing I would like to highlight is, if you look at this supplemental item, dataset and code, during the research, what we have is sometimes there's a research data, but sometimes there's a program code. If the author is willing to share it, we will make it available. So for example, you look at this, this is a data set. If you right click on it, and I'll find a code, and this is a code, right? I'll click on this as well. So let's look at the data set. The page will be open and jump to the section says this particular article has a data set. This is a data set name. And if you click on this hyperlink, it brings to us brings us to this particular page. As you can see, bibliographic data, Internet Things, this is the data set. You can download it. How do you download? Just register for a free account and you can download this, right? The same goes for the programming code. If you go to the code and data set section, it will bring us to this code, MATLAB. This is a MATLAB code. And for those who are familiar with MATLAB, this is a .m file. Right, so this is a .m file. This is also hosted on a platform called CodeOcean. If you click on it, it will open to a website, bring you to this CodeOcean platform. I will explain to you in more detail about this CodeOcean and IEEE data port sometime very soon, about 10 minutes later. But as of now, like this one is IEEE data port for data. Right? As of now, you notice that we have code, we have data set in the platform. All right, the next thing which is a lot of interest for a lot of us, which is how do I download the PDF? I want to save, I want to keep it. Yes, you can save it, but please make sure you are saving it for the purpose of reading, right? I have to make one thing very clear. Now, saving a PDF doesn't mean you understand the document. It doesn't mean you understand the knowledge. I remember when I was a student, sometimes, especially when I was working on research that I'm interested in, I save a lot of files. What I do is I read the title, I read the abstract. Okay, this article is interesting. Let me save the PDF. I save 100, 200, 300 PDF. Does that mean I have a good understanding? No, because out of the 300 plus articles that I have saved, I think I was only reading like less than 30 of them. So please, saving the document doesn't mean you understand the knowledge. It's different, right? It's like you buy the food from the supermarket, but if you don't eat it, you'll still be hungry. So it's not the purchasing of the food, it's the eating of the food. In this case, we are talking about the reading of the paper. But of course, you know, we start to save. So let's come back to save. One way is I open the PDF, I save the document one by one, but there is a quicker way. So as you can see, I'm selecting 1, 2, 3 and export. Sorry, download. Download PDF. As you can see, a maximum of 10 PDF can be downloaded at one time. In this case, I'm only selecting 3 and click on download. That's it. The system will download all the 3 PDF for you. The next thing that will be very useful is, let's say I'm a researcher who is working on sensors or Internet of Things. I would like to find out the latest research topics, the latest research publications. How should I do it? How should I do that? I come to sort by newest first, because I want to read the latest, right? The latest is here, so I'll read it. Then what happens is, I'll read 1, 2, 3, 4. As you can see, these are published this year. But the problem is, how about next week? Do I come back here and repeat the same search, apply these filters, sort by newest first, then start reading again? That's a very manual process, right? That's not how we do it. How we do it is, you can create a free personal account, and in fact, if you have been the member, you have been a student member, you can use your student member email address and password to log in for this account. Like mine, I have been using it for almost 2 decades, and it's still working. Once I log in, I will be able to see my name, and what I will do is I will come to set search alert, give a name, IoT sensor, click on save. What this does is your search has been saved, and if you go to my settings, alerts, and we have a lot of alerts. The ones that we currently use is what we call the saved alerts. You see, IoT sensor. This alert is pretty much like how you follow your friends or the stars from Facebook or Instagram. You like them, you follow them. So this alert is like you follow this research topic. You can rename it, you can edit it, you can disable it, you can delete it. What happens is, the system will send you an email to your email box telling you, hey Alex, for this week we have 5 new articles on the topic of sensor or Internet of Things or IoT. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And from there you'll be able to watch and read those 5 articles. Alright, so that's for the alerts. Alright, so that's pretty much what I want to show you in terms of IEEE Xplore. I don't see any questions coming. So other than searching, you can also browse. For example, these are the 5 major categories of content: books, conferences, courses, journals, and magazines. So let's look at journals and magazines. If you come to here, you'll find the list of all the journals. And if you look at anyone, IEEE transactions, IEEE transactions on antenna and propagation, click on it. It will tell you what this article is. You can click on early access to read the latest publications, current issues, and if you are a postgraduate student, you want to submit a paper to this particular transaction, just click on submit manuscript. They will bring you to a platform and you can start submission. All right, that's my last tip for those who are interested in writing and submitting to the IEEE journals. All right, that's my explanation and my update in terms of IEEE Xplore for the first part. Only for the first part. This is only to bring you up to speed. Next, what I have is this is what's coming next. I'll be showing you some new platform for managing your programming code as well as research data, which is called Ocean and Dataport. There's also a preprint server called Tech Archive, and we also have a platform. We partner with a platform called Overleaf to assist you in terms of LaTeX typesetting, and we also have some new directions or new initiatives we are working on. So that's the 4 things I'd like to share with you next. So I will show you by demonstration and going through those websites together with you so that you have a better understanding. The first one I would like to share with you is actually CodeOcean. So imagine you're looking at this paper. This is an IEEE paper, right? In the platform, and you read the articles, you notice that this logo says code available. What does this mean? It means for this particular research, is there's not only a PDF or a full text articles, as you can see, or reading articles, but there's also a programming code. If you click on it, it brings to this section, which I have shown just now. It tells us what this code is about, and this code is actually in MATLAB language, and this is the code. And of course, if you click on this blue icon logo here, it brings you to this website. And why this platform is worth mentioning? For those who are writing programmings or simulations on your computers, I'm sure you have to install some programs, MATLAB, C, Python, Java, R, S. Those require a local installation. Then you compile, you write your code, you compile, you debug, you troubleshoot, then your algorithm works or your simulation works. Now, CodeOcean is something like Google Doc comparing to your local hard disk software, which is similar to Microsoft Office. The old Microsoft Office requires you to install something on your computer. Then you can start using Word, you can start using PowerPoint, Excel. Well, for Google Doc, no need. You just go to a website, log in, and you can start working on Excel document. It doesn't require you to have a local installation. CodeOcean is similar to Google Doc.
Alex?
Yes.
Hi, Alex. We couldn't see the screen.
Oh, well, my apologies. Right, sorry.
No worries.
Right, thanks for pointing it out. This page. So, yeah, allow me to bring back the original page. This is fine. Yeah. Oops, sorry. Yeah, this is a page, right? This is the article which comes with the MATLAB. And if you look at the top of the article, it says, this thing says code available. Code available. If you click on it, it brings to the bottom of the screen where it tells us this is a MATLAB code and this is a small window. You click on the CodeOcean, it opens to this website. And from here, you can view the code. And not only the code, but also the data. As you can see on the left-hand side, this is the data. Oh, right, this is, the data is pretty big, 3.4 megabytes, so it can't be shown here. You can download the data. But of course, you need to sign up for accounts. Counting the account is specific. Once you sign up for accounts, you log in. Oops, sorry, I already have an account. You log in and oops. Right. You'll be able to see your name, this is Alex. And what you can do is reproducible run, which means compile. Right. Consume about 36 seconds. Proceed. It will take some time for the system to compile, and for those who are familiar with MATLAB, if you watch out this run window, run script, you see this is MATLAB, MathWorks, and it's running the sequence. And you will be generating a list of results to compare with the original set of results that the author has compiled. Alright, so if this program to be running, you can compare the results. So that's CodeOcean. And of course, in here, you can also look at your own capsule. If I look at the capsule here, actually, if I open in my own dashboard, there will be a number of program codes available, which you see I have been using or testing myself. And you can delete some of them. Delete, confirm, yes, delete. And of course, all these are actually codes that other researchers have been generating and being shared, right? So that's for that. You see, Alex run on September 24th. While compared to the original one, which is also run on February 22nd. So there's a comparison. So the ones that I have run, there are some figures. The ones that also run has some figures. You can compare the differences. You might be asking, why there's a difference? Well, in this example, there's no difference. But you can make some differences. For example, you can load your own data. You still use the same code, but run the analysis with your own data. Or you can even modify the codes. You change the algorithm, the pointer, the values, and then you run it, use the original or your own data. So that's code ocean. It helps you to run and manage your programming codes. That's for this. Next one is data set. Similarly, if you look at an article, this article, it says data sets available. If you click on it, they bring to this section. You click on this hyperlink, it brings you to this website. This is actually from IEEE Dataport. It's a free service as well. All you have to do is create an account, log in, and you will be able to download the data. You can also upload it. There's two terabyte of space for you to upload your data. It's like a data repository. This service is completely free, and all the licenses are under Creative Commons license. But again, whether it's IEEE Dataport or CodeOcean, I need to make one thing pretty clear, which is do not steal. You saw a very good code or algorithm in CodeOcean, you copy it, you claim, this is my code. That is called stealing. That is wrong. It's the same as plagiarism. You shouldn't do it. If you're ever going to use such a code, please make sure you provide proper citation and credit to the original author of the code. Who is the author of the code? It's usually the author of the article. So it's the same as providing a citation of those research articles. All right, so that's research data and CodeOcean. The next one I'd like to share with you is what we call Tech Archive. The URL is very simple, www.techarchive.org. This is what we call a preprint server. Now, for the content that they publish in Xplore, those are after peer review, which means it has been tested, it has been examined, the quality is assured, which assures the quality. Let me reload again. But sometimes there's another critical part, which is called preprint. What is a preprint? Preprint means, let's say I have finished my research. I have written something. Immediately, what I will do is I will upload to this platform. I will make it available to everybody else. As you can see, this is literally posted yesterday. This is how up to date it is. So preprint allows researchers to find most recent research topics and research publications. So generally, we will recommend you to use this platform to find the latest research topic. There is one challenge though, which is these papers are not peer reviewed. So you have to read it with your own critical analysis. With a question in your mind, asking yourself, is this true? Is this accurate? Is this the right direction? That's the difference between a preprint to an article which is peer reviewed. For example, if you read the articles from these transactions, all the articles are peer reviewed. But if you go to the preprint, this one, the archive, those are not peer reviewed. All right? But it shows the latest research. So that's for this. The next one is overleaf. For those who are typesetting your document using LaTeX or LaTeX, I will highly recommend try this platform. And why am I suggesting this is, if you go to login, do you see this? Login with, this is pretty familiar, isn't it? Click on this, you will log in, you use your student account number, and log in. And why this is helpful? Because if you search for a template, let's say I work on Cloud Overleaf. This is projects, so I'll click on new projects. There are presets available, and not only that, if you click on view all and you search for something that you are familiar, click on search. Did you see this? Conference template, journal paper template, conference template, and some of the conference, they even have their own dedicated template. So if you are going to submit to this particular conference, all you have to do, click on this. See, this is a preview, and you can use this as a template to start preparing your paper. It saves you a tremendous amount of time. If you want to find out the features and benefit, you can take a look at here for writings for groups. This account is totally free, and just now I have shown you when you log in, you can actually use your student member account to log in as well. So that saves you a lot of trouble. So this is already. The next one I would like to share with you is IEEE Future Directions. You notice I'm not directing you to a website. Why? It's about exploration, and it has more than one website. What do I mean by that? The first one is actually the what we call the portal of these new directions. It has more than just one topic. If you scroll down, we call the new initiatives. There are six or even more initiatives at the moment. If you scroll down, we have blockchain, brain, digital reality, future networks, quantum, robotics, rebooting computing. And all each one of these has its own dedicated portal. For example, digital reality, which is talking about AI, machine learning, artificial intelligence, virtual reality. If you click on this hyperlink, it will bring you to this website, IEEE Digital Reality homepage. And you'll find out the latest publications. We have some webinars, what's new, conferences, educations, podcasts, publications, what are the standards related to it. So this is actually very useful for also researchers to find one that is of your interest. And in fact, if you don't know which one is your interest, follow, read all of them. Then you will realize what's your interest. Right? So this is IEEE Future Directions. Each of the website will give you a lot of resources on what's related and feature articles and some webinars that are available online, which you can watch. And you can take this opportunity to expand your idea or understanding or knowledge or understanding. All right, so that's pretty much what's available for my sharing. I still have 5 minutes for Q&A. We do have two questions from the one participant. Number one, is it better to directly quote a source or paraphrasing is compulsory? I doubt anyone will directly copy and paste the phrase from the questions. I mean, from the original researchers. You can't do that. It doesn't show anything. I copy one sentence. Normally, if you read other people's publications, how do they quote? They actually quote the research result or publications from others. They are not quoting directly the sentences. They will quote what's the research methods, what results they're getting, what analysis do they use. So if anyone who is doing that, I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. Question number two, I don't have a key answer to that. The question is, what are the key points that should be added in paper which increase the chances of publication? If anyone has one answer for that, that's like an answer to a million-dollar question. Why? Because it varies. It depends on whether you are doing original research, whether you are doing experiment, whether you are doing or simulations. It also depends on your area of research or your topics. It also depends on what do you mean by key points in which section. For every section, there are always key points. For example, in the introduction, you definitely need to have an overview of the previous research. You need to highlight your current research topic or hypothesis. You explain your research topics. In the methodology, you need to highlight your research methodology. In the analysis, your results and your analysis. So all these are key points. There's no single key point says like the golden finger. The moment I add this key point, my paper will get published. There is no such thing as that kind of key point. All right? It really varies depending on your paper. Then some people may ask, yeah, of course I know that. Then how do I do? What should I do? What you should do is, instead of focusing on publishing, you should spend much more time on your reading. Your aim is to publish. But you ask yourself, how much effort did you put in reading other people's publications? Did you read how other people write? Did you read why that people write that way? Those answers lie within the papers that have been published. That's my answer to your second question. Any other questions?
Alex, it looks like we do not have any questions now at the moment from the chat box.
All right, thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Alex, for sharing with us your expertise and your excellent presentations. So just want to double check one more time if you have any questions for Alex. If not, we will move to the next agenda item. So our next exciting agenda item will be the quiz sessions. So for the quiz sessions, let me pass the board to Abdul and Muzamil to give us a briefing on how the quiz sessions will be conducted. Abdul and Muzamil, please.
Here is Muzamil Mahmood. Participants, you are requested to please check your emails and follow the link to the quiz number 5. The time of the quiz would be only 3 minutes, and the quiz will start after 1 minute. So you are requested to please visit your emails and click on the link of quiz number 5. Thank you. Over to you, Evan.
So now the quiz session is currently ongoing, am I right?
Evan, it will start after 1 minute.
Okay.
Maybe you can share the quiz URL on the screen so that in case some of them we can't find it in the email.
Okay. Alex, we have sent the quiz link to them separately.
All right, thanks a lot. And just for our participants, oh, that's the survey on activity. And I think for those who can't find them, find the email. You can also look at the chat box.
Yes.
Yeah, there's a link in there.
Yes. And Evel, Prof. Bin has joined. Maybe we can invite her to say some thoughts.
Oh, yes. Hi, Professor Bin. Can you hear us?
Hello.
Yes, hi.
Yeah.
Good to see you here.
Sorry for joining late. Because I had class from 12:30 until 2 p.m.
I see, no worries. We are good to have you here. Yeah. Would you like to say a few words for our attendees here?
Yeah. So I think the session is good for the student and young professional and other people who are interested in this topic. And 10 minutes ago, I attended a few minutes before moving to another room. So I saw some slides, Alex Liu, and attend a few minutes. So I think it's very good for students. And I hope you enjoy this session and I study a lot of experience through this session. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Professor Bin. Thanks a lot. Yeah. So Abdul and Muzamil, is the quiz sessions okay so far?
Yeah. We can move on to the next agenda item.
Okay, great. Okay, so now I would like to invite our Region 10 student representative, Ms. Savita, to give us a closing remark. Savita, please.
Thank you, Ibel. Let me share the slides. Can you see my slides full screen?
It's not a full screen right now.
I think it's stuck. So most probably I'll present this way.
Okay, sure.
Yeah. Thanks, Alex. Sorry I could not show the slides full screen, but thank you so much, Alex, for the very insightful presentation. I'm pretty much sure it's useful for all the attendees. Especially I like the part that can connect to the Overleaf and do the editing in LaTeX. This is very much important and time-saving at the same time. So as a token of appreciation for your talk today, Alex, this is a very e-token, I would say, and I hope we can meet in person and give this token to you. Please.
Thank you,
Alex, and also thank you so much, Ival, for doing an awesome job in moderating this session today.
Thank you, it's my pleasure. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Alex. Thank you, Ival, and guys, tomorrow, this is our session for tomorrow. It's going to be something interesting because this is collaboratively reorganized by IEEE Center of Leadership Excellence and VOLT. We will be covering about leadership of students, how leadership can enhance your professional career to IEEE VOLT program and CLE, and also a very interesting panel discussion from senior to young professional and student volunteer leaders. So do not miss it, guys. It's scheduled for 1 to 3:20 p.m. Bangkok time. Right, so coming up next is our networking session. We will start at 2:40 Bangkok time, and it's going to be something interesting because some of our SAC team will be joining us today, and they will be sharing some interesting facts of volunteering with R10 SAC. So I hope to see you all there. And I also would like to say a big thanks to our team and especially Ivel for helping us with organizing this session. And thank you all. See you tomorrow. Have a nice day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
There is a networking sessions link in the chat box that I hope everyone can join.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.